Exposition of the Divine Principle, Chapter 1, Principles of Creation. In this presentation, we will study Section 6. Section 6, The Spiritual World and the Physical World, whose center is human beings. The universe was created after the pattern of a human being, who is in the image of God's dual characteristics. Corresponding to the human mind and body, the universe consists of the invisible world, spiritual world, and the visible world, physical world, both of which are real and substantial. The invisible world is so called because we cannot perceive it through our five physical senses. The two worlds together form the cosmos. The spiritual world is in the position of subject partner, and the physical world, object partner. The latter is like a shadow of the former. When we shed our physical bodies, we enter the spiritual world as spirits, and live there for eternity. The position of human beings in the cosmos has three aspects. First, God created human beings to be the rulers of the universe. The universe does not of itself have internal sensibility toward God. Hence, God does not govern the universe directly. Rather, God endowed human beings with sensibilities to all things in the universe, and gave them the mandate to rule over the universe directly. Human beings, composed of flesh, which can dominate the physical world, and spirit, which can dominate the spiritual world, have the potential to rule both worlds. Second, God created human beings to be the mediator and the center of harmony of the cosmos. When a person's flesh and spirit unite through give-and-take action, the physical and spiritual worlds can also begin give-and-take action through that person. They thus achieve harmonious integration to construct a cosmos that is responsive to God. A true person acts as the mediator and center of harmony between the two worlds. Third, God created human beings to encapsulate in a substantial form the essences of everything in the cosmos. The human spirit encapsulates all of the elements found in the spiritual world. The human body encapsulates all of the elements of the physical world. Accordingly, since human beings contain within themselves the essences of all things in the cosmos, each person is a microcosm. The physical self consists of the dual characteristics of the physical mind, subject partner, and the physical body, object partner. The physical mind directs the physical body to maintain the functions necessary for its survival, protection, and reproduction. For the physical self to grow in good health, it must absorb air and sunlight, which are intangible yang types of nourishment, and eat food and drink water, which are tangible yin types of nourishment. Our spirit self is a substantial yet invisible reality, which can be apprehended only through the spiritual senses. It is the subject partner to our physical self. Our spirit can communicate directly with God and is meant to govern the spiritual world, including the angels. In appearance, our spirit self matches our physical self, After we shed the physical self, we enter the spiritual world and live there for eternity. The reason we desire an eternal life is because our innermost self is the spirit self, which has an eternal nature. Our spirit self consists of the dual characteristics of the spirit mind, subject partner, and spirit body, object partner. The spirit mind is the center of the spirit self, and it is where God dwells. The spirit grows through give and take action between two types of nourishment: life elements from God, yang type, and the vitality elements from the physical self, yin type. The spirit self also returns an element to the physical self, which we call the living spirit element. To summarize, the physical self grows through the give and take action between the yang type elements of light and air and the yin type elements of food and water. Likewise, the spirit self grows through the give and take action between the yin type vitality elements, which come from the good actions of the physical self, and the yang type life elements, which are the spirit and truth that come from God. The spirit self returns to the physical self the living spirit elements, which are the inspiration and good health experienced by a person living a life of goodness. The spirit can grow only while it abides in the flesh. Thus, the relationship between the physical self and the spirit self is similar to that between a tree and its fruit. The spirit self can attain perfection only during a person's earthly life. The growth of the spirit self toward perfection progresses through the three orderly stages ordained by the principle of creation. A spirit in the formation stage of life is called a form spirit, in the growth stage, a life spirit, and in the completion stage, a divine spirit. A person fully matures as a divine spirit when the spirit self and physical self unite through perfect give and take action centered on God and form the four position foundation. A divine spirit can accurately feel and perceive every reality in the spiritual world. All the sensibilities of the spirit self are cultivated through the reciprocal relationship with the physical self during earthly life. Therefore, only when a person reaches perfection and is totally immersed in the love of God while on earth can he or she fully delight in the love of God as a spirit after death. Sinful conduct aggravates evil and ugliness in the spirit of a fallen person, while the redemption of sins granted during earthly life opens the way for the spirit to become good. Matthew 16:19, "Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven." It is not God who decides whether a person's spirit enters heaven or hell upon his death. It is decided by the spirit himself. Since the human spirit self can grow only in the soil of the physical self, the multiplication of human spirits takes place at the same time that physical selves multiply during earthly life. The relationship between the spirit mind and physical mind is like that between internal nature and external form. When they become one through give and take action, with God as their center, they progress toward the purpose of creation. This united entity is the mind of a human being. The conscience is that faculty of the human mind which, by virtue of its inborn nature, always directs us towards what we think is good. However, due to the fall, human beings have become ignorant of God, and thus ignorant of the absolute standard of goodness. Hence, a person's conscience may pursue goodness according to an improper standard set up in ignorance. This causes frequent contention, even among those who advocate a conscientious life. The original mind is that faculty of the human mind which pursues absolute goodness. It relates to the conscience as internal nature to external form. The original mind repels faulty standards of goodness by correcting the conscience. As long as our spirit mind and physical mind are under the bondage of Satan, the functioning entity they form through their give and take action is called the evil mind. The evil mind continually drives people to do evil. End of section 6.